Now we're going to sort of take a side trip because it becomes important when we're talking about integration and ennui and decision making. It becomes important to remember that, you know, God's looking at all this stuff. What kind of decision is he making? And I go through this with him pretty much every day. Because it's the main thing I'm supposed to learn at this stage of my spiritual life. And at some stage in your spiritual life, it'll be front and center for you too. The point is that if you really were God, and you got all these humans that you yourself wanted to exist, good, bad, and indifferent, how do you adjudicate amongst them? You as God want them to be free to choose whatever and to have the consequences that freely go with that. And of course, if they choose you, the consequences that freely go with that are up to you as God to accept or not. But you know, God's always got his arms out to us, and we don't have ours to him. How do you live with that? How do you adjudicate that? Moreover, how do you adjudicate it between the ones who want to integrate with you as God and can't do it of themselves, so you have to decide what you'll do at your end, but also those who are wanting to integrate with you, and you decide what you're going to do with them, but then there are all those other people around them who don't want to integrate with you. So the ones that don't want and the ones that do want are going to be at loggerheads most of the time. And none of them are any good. All of us humans are a waste of time. It's not about that. Do you want God or not? Well, the ones who don't are going to be really miffed to have to be around the ones who do. And the ones who do are really going to end up being miffed about being around the ones who don't. So on top of all the other problems in the human race of juridical issues, how we treat each other, and usually badly or messed up, you got the juridical issue of, well, see, these are the people who are choosing me, God, versus the ones who aren't. And the ones who aren't are mistreating the ones who want me. So how do I treat the ones who don't? Because they're also mistreating the ones who want me. You see, it's a really thorny thing. Okay, but it's not just restricted to people treating people. What about when, as just is happening to me now, your air conditioning goes bad at 1 o'clock in the morning, and you got drip, 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 while you're trying to get some work done, and you now can't go to sleep because of the drip, 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 drip. And when you go to call the people who can fix it, their phone isn't working. How does God adjudicate that? The juridical problems between stuff that doesn't work and you need it to work because you want him. And even if you don't want him, somebody around you does. And so your stuff needs to work for the sake of the person who wants him. Juridically, I mean, from God's point of view, I mean, if you don't want me, then, you know, wipe your hands free. That's not really how he thinks about it, but you know, hey, you don't want anything to do with me? Then I stand off. That's the only right thing to do. Okay, but what do you do? How do you adjudicate a decision when one of the people in the mix is somebody who wants you and the other one is not? Shouldn't there be a difference? Now, the bigger picture, even though, is, but there are millions of us. How do you adjust for whatever I might be doing wrong? Whether I mean it or not is beside the point. Whether I want God or not, which on a certain level of adjudication, it doesn't matter either. But there is a level where it does matter. Because if I want God, then God can do something with that to make me grow. If I don't want God, yeah, he can make me grow anyway, but he's not gonna. Okay, but if he can make me grow from anything that happens to me, and the goal is to integrate with him, and he's out to show Isaiah 54:1, which is sterile barren kids. Now here's the kicker. A whole lot of bad stuff can happen to me because I want him. That couldn't profitably happen to somebody who doesn't. See, this is the heart of the cross. This is what Christians don't understand. They have this cockamamie idea that if you're a good Christian, your life is supposed to be nice. And if your life is not nice, then somehow you must be doing something wrong. That was what, you know, Job's three friends kept on telling him. Well, Job, you know, you had a really nice life, which means that you were spiritual. And now that you're having a bad life, you must not be spiritual. It took Elihu to break it. Elihu, the youngest of the four, comforting Job. Yeah, cold comfort. Okay, well, Christ is the only perfect person who ever lived, and look what happened to him. So the conclusion we ought to be drawing is that, high as Christians, we should expect the spit to hit the fan as part of spiritual training. But more importantly, as part of, well, high, if I want to integrate with God, then like Paul says at the end of, what was it, Romans 8, he threw that at me. What do I care what man can do to me? Okay? There's no height, no depth, no breadth that can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus. Okay, but how else is that going to be demonstrated? The spit has to hit the fan. Now, to the unbeliever, or to somebody who doesn't want God, that sounds like God's being mean. That's going to make such a person conclude even more, well, if this is how God treats those who love God, then I sure as hell don't want him. So whatever integration method you're going toward, it's going to steer you more in that same direction. And of course, that's what it's for. Christ, look what happened to him, the worst. And yet he wanted God the most. Look at John 17 to see how much. He was grateful. He was grateful for the cross. He told the disciples, I've longed for this day. I forget where that is, but it's in the Gospels. Just look, you know, toward the end. At the Last Supper passages. So, logically, the decision that we make is going to result in, at least half the time, worse circumstances. When you start going toward God in your mind, and you start wanting to study Bible, count on it, 19,222 things are going to go wrong to try to stop you from doing that. If you start wanting to make the right decision, and you start wanting to think about God all the time, count on it, it's going to become 50,000 times harder to do that. Every kind of obstacle there can be is going to be in the way of going in the right direction. So the decision that God makes, you want me, I will grow you. In other words, make good on your desire. You want me, so you desire to know me. Okay, I'm going to make that happen. Okay, but that means depth, breadth, height, width, like Paul was saying in Ephesians 3. Okay, well, you need the depth to get the height. Any builder of a building will tell you that. If you don't dig that foundation really, really deep, your building's going to topple over like so many of the, you know, the Chinese high-rises have done in the past. I don't know if you've seen the stories about it, but in the last couple of years, there have been some pretty fantastic stories of really tall high-rises in China. I think it was in South China that fell over because the foundation wasn't dug deep enough for the amount of height that they went. Okay, well, if you're going to go high with God, you're going to go deep with God. You got to have some kind of cross in order to withstand it, the thorn in the flesh thing that Paul was talking about. So the decision that God makes, on the one hand with you, because it's to know Him, and because it's all things work together for good, end of Romans 8, means the sterile barren kids, Isaiah 54:1, and a whole lot more suffering. Which has an effect on people around you. And the format of that suffering, the way it comes to you, can be something as benign and yet irritating as dripping air ducts at 1 o'clock in the morning. Not even necessarily people. Or, as also happened to me, people who, when they moved out, left their water on, so it dripped all over my apartment. Caused a lot of trouble. That's happened to me many times. Not just here, but in other places that I've lived. It's almost like the apartment can't be baptized unless it has a flooding problem. Okay. And over your lifetime, you'll begin to see patterns of stuff like that happen to you. And those around you might be used as agents of it. I mean, you know, they're acting of their own free will. God foreknows what to do. And it's basically a question of taking the lemons He foreknows and turning them into lemonade for you. But that's justice. But it's not justice the way humans typically think of justice. The goal of the decision He makes is, hi, you want to know me? I'm going to make that happen with everything that happens to you. No matter what it is, good, bad, or indifferent. And the agents who are doing whatever they're doing around your life are also going to be good, bad, and indifferent. And some of what happens to you is going to be a witness to them, just like to Job's three friends. And some of it is going to be like unfathomable to them. And some of it they're going to be like accusatory. And some of it at times, and you won't even know this until it's gotten so bad that they even wake you up to it. They realize, oh, wow, you really believe in God. It's not just something that you say in order to, I don't know, be puffed up. See, a lot of the unbelievers, a lot of people don't believe in God the way we do. They really think we're trying to sell them something. They really do. It's like the whole Windows 10 thing. That is such a scam, I can't even begin to tell you. Okay? It's a total scam. Yeah, and that's why they're selling it so hard. Oh, it's free. Yeah, free. Free to have every kind of problem in the book. Free to have your data slurped. Free to be sued by somebody who you happen to write an email to on your machine. But, oh, in the fine print, Windows reserves the right to take all of your data and slurp it. It's in the contract. So now, you know, somebody petitions in a divorce for Microsoft to supply the data, and you happen to be one of the contacts on somebody else's machine. Well, now you're part of that. Now your stuff gets exposed. It's a nightmare. Total nightmare. So it's being sold. You can't even get rid of that stupid Get Windows 10 thing in your system tray now. if you were unlucky enough to not know how to keep it from being installed. It nags you every day. And then if you ever give in to it, well, you only get 3 days before it's going to just install itself on you. That's unfair, too. How does God adjudicate that? That's one of the most unfair things to ever happen in history. You know, we tend to think of unfair things and big bad things as, you know, war and rape and murder. Okay, but what about murdering your time? For millions upon millions of people, this thing is going on. That's as big an injustice as I can think of in the world right now. Bigger than a whole lot of other injustices. Because, it basically can grind economies to a whole halt. How does God adjudicate that? Well, see, at times like that, if you are like, well, God's going to handle it, somebody will be watching you. And they know how hard this is for you. And you're really not trying to sell them on God. You're trying to get through the next 5 minutes. And they say, wow, this is, you actually really believe in God. You're not just saying this to sell me on some idea like Windows 10 is trying to be foisted on everybody. You really believe in God. Okay, but how could that moment of epiphany occur for the other person if the spit didn't happen to you? See, God foreknows what has to happen to you for somebody else to get their epiphany. Wouldn't you want that? Now, what I started to say when I started this audio was, where I was going with it is that the lesson that he's conveying with all this that becomes front and center in your life at some point is, hi, look at how you need to rule. You got 16 bazillion people in your kingdom. They all got different needs. They all got different orientations. They all got different positive volition. They all got different sticking points and things that they really understand. How do you, as it were, apportion among them events, property, contacts, roles, jobs in their lives so that the thing as a whole is synergistic? Of course, my answer to him is always, I can't handle this. I can't rule this. How am I ever going to be able to rule? I don't even have the information, and if I did, I don't know what kind of decision to make. You choose one person's experience over another person's experience because of the sake of somebody, you know, 15 counts away that's going to happen 15 years later. I mean, that's all the kind of adjudication he's doing. Today, tomorrow, the next day, we go through whatever we go through today, tomorrow, the next day. And it seems to be right or wrong. But that's only for the moment. What about 20 years from now? And of course, the big promise he's making is, whatever seems wrong now, honey, I got a plan for that. That once you know what that plan is and once you see it unfold, you're going to be really glad it happened. Now, I've seen that happen for a lot of things in my life. I've been kidnapped. I've been stabbed. And even at the time, I knew God had a purpose for it, so I really wasn't very upset about that. But boy, oh boy, when something goes wrong with Windows, I'm ballistic. I can't take small things going wrong. Big things, yes. Small things, no. Okay, but what's a small thing? What's a big thing? What seems big to you or me now is going to seem small to us later. And what seems small to us now is big later. And what seems right to us now is going to be revealed as being wrong later. And what seems wrong to us now is going to be revealed as being right later, because you know what? Romans 8:28 is true. God makes everything work together for good for himself. See, that's what you need the Greek for. You got to see that. It's in the proleptic position. It's in the heroic accusative. And it uses an intransitive verb called sunergeo, which means that it doesn't take an object. But Paul is using it improperly, using improper Greek on purpose, to show that God makes the impossible work for his own benefit. Well, if he's doing it for his benefit, what do you think he's doing for you and me? But can we see it? No. Does it seem impossible? Yeah. One of the first questions I'm going to have, I want answered when I get up there. Why the Holocaust? How could all of those poor Jews and gypsies and communists or whoever they were, gays, that the Nazis tortured to death, sometimes slowly, sometimes quickly, how could there be any justice on that? How can you make good on that? How can you make good on the rape of Nanking? The lady who wrote the book about the rape of Nanking was so upset by her findings and study that she killed herself. I forget her name now. But just, you know, Google on the rape of Nanking book. There's only one written. It's by one Chinese girl. I think she was Japanese or Chinese. It depressed her so badly after she wrote the book. It's got some really graphic pictures in it, too. She killed herself. I don't blame her. Some days I want to kill myself because I look at all this stuff that's not being redressed. And quite frankly, the Windows 10 thing is right up there with the rape of Nanking and the Holocaust. Because it's not physical damage. We don't realize how much damage there is. All the lost money, all the lost time, millions upon millions upon millions of hours that could have been spent making money, being with your family, paying your bills, have to get spent on Windows glitches that could have been avoided instead. It's criminal. Just criminal. Okay, but killing myself isn't going to do any good. How does God adjudicate that? He says he does. He says he does it for his own benefit. I would really like to know how. Wouldn't you? So, the integration ennui decision of God, by God, for God, Romans 8:28, is a rather big deal. It's going to have to be. Because if he's doing something that's pleasing him, and that's what Isaiah 54 and 55 both say, the whole chapters, then how big is that? I can't imagine. Seriously, I really don't know. I know him. And every single day he's teaching me something about it, basically along the lines of, see, if you finish the course, which I'm likely to do, because where else am I going to go? Then I'm going to be crowned and I'm going to have a whole bunch of people under me as a kingdom who didn't learn, so I better, for their sake. That's what he's doing this for. This is the thing that kills me about him most of all, and I'm starting to cry now, so I'm going to have to sign off. He loves us. This is the love of God. He's not sitting there pointing the finger. Whenever you do something wrong, it shrinks your ability to enjoy life. Certainly shrinks your ability to know him. So there's always going to be all these shrunken people in heaven. Saved, but shrunk. How do you save them after they're saved? Well, you be king of a kingdom, and you give them stuff to do every day. And you have your little ceremonies or your culture or whatever it is we're going to develop up there so that the hoi polloi can learn what they wouldn't learn down here. And that makes me cry too, because that's what I want more than anything. So if I want it, how much more God? So what kind of integration decision am I going to want to make? Faced with all this suffering,